today as a part of our series, The Invitation. I want to talk about the next 40 days. That's what I have entitled the message. Last week, I feel like Rob and myself, we sort of took you guys by surprise. We sprung something on you, 40 days of prayer and fasting, something that we haven't done as a church. And so I feel like I owe you some explanation. Prayer, we understand. Fasting, not so much. And that's what I want to help us with today. Just the very thought of fasting makes us kind of nervous inside. And so if you're a little nervous, that's natural. Good. I'm glad. I just want to give you a chance, though, to get over it, to put your mind at ease, and to help you over your fasting phobia, especially if you've never fasted before. It's a Bible thing. As a matter of fact, you fasted today and you don't even know it. If you had breakfast, you fasted. You broke the overnight fast. Probably hadn't eaten for 12 hours. So in essence, really, everybody fasts once a day. Why 40 days, though? Why fasting? What's it all about? Well, I've already had questions about fasting, and I want to just say some things today to help you relax. I want to do a teaching on it in sort of a relaxed way. I actually had envisioned that I would just get a chair and sit up here and talk to you a little bit about fasting, but with everything else, I just didn't get around to it because I never could sit down for a second and relax. But I want to relax right now and let you know that we're going to be fasting not because it's swimsuit season, but rather it's to prepare ourselves for what we're asking God to do in our church immediately and over the next 10 years, and specifically beginning with this year's fall outreach, our Beggar's Night pit stop. And I want to begin, and this is sort of my outline here, by answering some questions about fasting and invite you to into all of that, and then to give you some directions as to how we're going to proceed. That's what today is all about. It's very simple. I just want to do some teaching. So no flash. I'll be mentioning a lot of Bible verses today, but I'm only going to ask you to turn to two, and that would be Matthew chapter 6, verses 6 through 18, and 1 John 5, 14 and 15. Matthew 6, 16 through 18, and 1 John 5, 14 and 15. And we'll get to those in just a few moments. So I'm going to begin by answering a few questions. And this is just a short biblical overview of fasting and how it ties in with prayer in the scriptures. So what is fasting exactly? Biblically, it is the voluntary giving up of food in order to focus on prayer and fellowship with God. It's a voluntary going without food in order to focus on prayer and fellowship with God. In both the Old Testament and in the New Testament, the word that is used there means to cover the mouth, basically to not eat, to abstain from eating. It is voluntary most of the time, meaning that it's not coerced, but it may be made by invitation, and that's what I want to extend to all of us. I want to invite you in to a time, a season of prayer and fasting. Prayer and fasting go hand in hand, but that's not always the case because you can pray without fasting and you can fast without prayer. But when you combine those two activities and dedicate that activity, those two, to God's glory, that's when it reaches its full impact and effectiveness. Having a dedicated time of prayer and fasting is not a way of manipulating God into doing what you want. It's simply a tool that God has given us to help us shift our focus and our reliance away from ourselves and onto God, so that we can then watch Him work, so that we can see His will accomplished in our lives, so that we can see strongholds over our lives and the lives of our loved ones broken, so that we can see breakthroughs in our own life by the hand of God. Fasting brings us to a place of humility. I'll talk about that in just a minute, where we recognize we can't do this on our own. Just as we give up food, so we forfeit our own natural inclinations and we turn over our will to God. Somebody said that fasting, if you go long enough, you'll die. And that's symbolically what fasting is. It's saying I'm dying to myself so that I can be alive to God and what He wants to do. in my life. So who fasted in the Bible and why? Well, a bunch of people fasted for a lot of reasons, too many to mention. My best theological resource on fasting said that fasting is never given a clear definition in Scripture as to why you do it. It's always seen in the way that it's worked out in the lives of the people that are recorded in Scripture. In other words, they fasted for a lot of different reasons, and a lot of people did it. So fasting takes its meaning based on what you're fasting and what you're praying for in the moment towards a specific situation or life event or whatever it may be. The Old Testament law specifically required prayer and fasting for only one occasion. God only has one mandate in the Old Testament when all of the people of Israel were to fast, and that was on the Day of Atonement. And that became their tradition. They abided by that law. In Jeremiah 36, many years after the giving of the law, 800 years after the giving of the law, they were still observing that on the Day of Atonement, that one day a year. And that's Jeremiah 36. Jeremiah called it the Day of Fasting, and everybody knew what he was talking about. It even carried over into the New Testament, Acts 27. It's just called the fast. Moses fasted for 40 days and 40 nights when he was up on Mount Sinai receiving the law from God. There's one example of 40 days. King Jehoshaphat called for a fast in all of Israel. There's a corporate, not a personal fast. When they were about to be attacked by the Moabites and the Ammonites in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. In response to Jonah's preaching, and I'm going to mention this in a little while, the men of Nineveh fasted. They put on sackcloth, which was a sign of humility and repentance. That's Jonah chapter 3. So even pagans fasted in repentance towards God. David fasted when he learned that Saul and Jonathan had been killed in 2 Samuel chapter 1. Nehemiah had a time of fasting and prayer upon learning that Jerusalem was still in ruins. Darius, the king of Persia, so you have to know a little bit of your Old Testament if you don't. This is a chance to go and research what I'm saying. Darius, who was the king of Persia, fasted all night when he was forced to put Daniel in the lion's den. That's Daniel chapter 6. That's just to name a few in the Old Testament. Prayer and fasting also occurs in the New Testament. Anna worshipped night and day, fasting and praying at the temple, awaiting the arrival of the Messiah. That's Luke chapter 2. John the Baptist taught his disciples to pray and to fast, Mark chapter 2. Jesus fasted for 40 days. There's another example of a 40-day fast. He fasted for 40 days and 40 nights before his temptation by Satan in Matthew chapter 4. The church at Antioch fasted in Acts chapter 13, and then they sent off Paul and Barnabas on their first missionary journey. The very next chapter, Paul and Barnabas, then they spent time themselves praying and fasting for the appointment of elders in every church that they had planted on their recent missionary journey. I'm going to talk about that in just a few moments as well. Does the Bible, another question, does the Bible require or does it recommend prayer and fasting? The Word of God does not specifically command believers to spend time in prayer and fasting. But at the same time, prayer and fasting is definitely something that we should be doing as the church. As a matter of fact, Jesus expected us to. And the Father rewards us when we do it right, when we do it for the right reasons. Matthew chapter 6, here's our first text, verses 16 through 18. And Jesus is talking to his followers, his disciples, and he says, "When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do." So don't do it this way. "For they disfigure their faces to show that they're fasting. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full." They're doing it as a show. Look how holy I am. Look how spiritual I am. I want everybody to know that I'm fasting. Jesus says, don't do it that way. "But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face. Clean up so that no one will know," in other words, "so that it will not be obvious to others that you're fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you." So, what does fasting and prayer accomplish? What's the big picture? Spending time in prayer and fasting is not automatically effective in accomplishing the desires of the one who is fasting. Fasting or no fasting, God only promises to answer our prayers as we ask according to His will. That brings me to my second text. So again, just a basic teaching today. 1 John 5, 14 and 15 says this. So when we're fasting and praying, again, it's not a way to manipulate God. We may or may not get what we want, whether we fast or not and pray. 1 John says this. This is the confidence that we have in approaching God. That if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us, meaning that He answers us. He always hears us, but He answers in the way in which we pray. Verse 15 says, and we know that if He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we ask of Him. In Isaiah's day, the people grumbled that they had fasted, but that God didn't answer the way that they wanted. Isaiah responded by saying, an external show of prayer and fasting in exactly the wrong way, that is without the proper heart attitude, it's futile. God is not going to hear you when you pray that way, but when you pray according to His will, He will indeed answer, fasting or not. Fasting adds the emphasis. It demonstrates your seriousness about the fact that you want God's will done in your life, whatever it may be. How can I know if I'm praying according to God's will and fasting as well? Well, if you're praying and fasting for things that honor and glorify God, then you're praying for God's will. So that's a great question. And some of those things you know. Some are a little ambiguous, certainly. But some things we know are God's will. We find them in His Word for our lives. If we're asking for God, of God something that is not honoring to Him, something that is plainly not God's will for our lives, God is under no obligation whether we fast or not. But He does promise to give us wisdom to help us know how to pray God's will. James 1:5 says this, if any one of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. And so fasting is an invitation God is extending to us, even right now, for the next 40 days, to join in a long line of devout people from the past who have, for a lot of reasons, fasted and prayed. They've turned to God for specific things and awaited His answer according to His will. And the things that we're going to be praying and fasting for over the next 40 days, we know they're His will for personal righteousness, for our availability to be able to extend invitations to people to come to church, to meet Jesus face to face, to be brought into His kingdom. All of those things, we know those things are God's will. For our loved ones to come to know Christ, we know that that's God's will. And so our fasting and our praying can be effective because we know that we're praying according to God's will. And He has extended us this invitation. He is extending this invitation so that we might be spiritually ready then ourselves. We also know that that's His will. He's extending His invitation to us in preparation for what He wants to do in this church over the next 10 years. And so that then we may take that invitation that He's extended to us and be prepared to extend it to others and then await and watch, see how God will answer. So we're praying really and fasting to prepare ourselves to see the people in our circle of influence come to the Lord, but to pray as well for ourselves that we would be ready to extend invitations for people to meet Jesus in the coming days, over the next 10 years, and immediately when we have this event on October 31st, the Beggar's Night Pit Stop. So I just want to talk now just categorically about why we want to fast and pray or the motive behind our fasting and praying, because Jesus has extended to us this invitation to do it. And we want to, as I've already mentioned, fast and pray in obedience to Jesus' teaching to his church. He expects us and he has invited us to do that. And that's where we need to begin, in obedience to him. There are many more reasons in Scripture why we should fast, but this is primary. Jesus has expected us. He's demonstrated that in Matthew chapter 6 that I just read. Jesus is giving to his disciples foundational teaching about some things that he expects will be a part of the life of his followers. And so speaking to his disciples, and so catch the parallel here. Matthew chapter 6 verse 2, he says, "So when you give to the needy," don't do it that way, do it this way. There's a proper way to do it. "When you give to the needy, don't let everybody know that you're doing it. Do it in secret. That way God can reward you." In other words, if you're a follower of Jesus, you will give to the needy. That's the expectation, and there's no problem. We understand that. Then he goes on to say in Matthew 6, 5, "And when you pray," don't do it that way, do it this way. In other words, if you are a follower of Jesus, you will pray. When you pray, this is how you're to do it. And then a few verses later, he drops the bomb, not on them, but he drops the bomb on us, because this is a part of the normal Jewish ritual, religious expectation of that day, and they still adhere to these three things today. They adhere to giving to the needy, to praying, and also to fasting. He says in verses 16 through 18, or he begins, "When you fast," so it's when you give to the needy, when you pray, when you fast, don't do it this way, do it that way. So apparently, if you are a follower of Jesus, you will not only give to the needy, you will not only pray, but you will also fast. That's the expectation. Fasting is for everyone who follows Christ. It's a tool that God has given us to increase our spiritual power and to help us communicate more intimately with God. That's the invitation. And if we don't make use of it, we will be missing out on much of what God wants to do in and through our lives. The closeness that we feel when we come to those times, to receive the help that we need from God's hand, because just as we're fasting, and if you've never fasted before, when you do, all of a sudden, it's just this awesome thing that happens. You begin to realize how much you counted on food, and you're afforded then the opportunity to shift that dependence on food to God. You begin to realize, wow, God is closer than what I thought, and just like I depend upon food, I realize through this time of fasting, I can actually be close enough to realize that I can really depend on him, even for some of the most crucial, critical things in my life. I can really count on God. You know, I can make myself a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, but only God can change my heart. And that's what fasting sort of does in a very elementary way. When we act in obedience to what Jesus has expected of us, remember, it's not commanded, but it's by invitation. Jesus expects his people will do this. Secondly, we want to fast and pray to express our humility before God and to demonstrate our dependence upon him. And that's what I've been talking about. That's the invitation here. It's always good to be reminded of our humanity when we come to God. We don't come to God as if we're an equal with him and make demands. But we come to God with a feeling, a sense of helplessness, which is not, by the way, a handicap, but it's actually a head start. That's one less thing that God has to work through with you to get to your need. If we come in humility before God, it casts us upon God's mercy. It rightly makes us then dependent upon him. And oh, how we hate to feel dependent on anything or anyone. Oh my goodness. Fasting breaks the dependence on food, but then it heightens our awareness of our dependence upon God. When we come to him in the right way, and the right way to do that is in humility and dependence. James 4:10 says, "Humble yourselves before the Lord." When you come before God, humble yourselves, and he will lift you up. There are so many ways that we can demonstrate our humility before God. But choosing to go without food for the sake of spiritual things is one of the more practical ways. Why? When a person fasts, it won't be long until your stomach starts saying, "Food, I need food." That physical urge is then a test. Will you do what your flesh is urging you to do, or will you rely upon God for your strength? Fasting is a very tangible way to teach our minds and our bodies that we do not have to gratify the urges of our bodies. We can actually say no when we're hungry. Imagine that. And when we do this, we demonstrate to God that we're His. We're giving that to you, God. And that we are more needful of His righteousness, of His power, of His wisdom, of His direction, than we actually need physical nourishment. And I couldn't help, when I got to this point, to think about Jesus and His temptation in the wilderness. In Luke and Matthew, chapter 4, when Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil, after fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, He was hungry. And the tempter came to Him and said, "So if your mind is not bad enough, if your body is not mad enough, when you start to fast, expect an attack from the devil. He will come and tell you, go ahead, no big deal, eat." Look what happens. Jesus was fasting in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. And the tempter, the devil, came to Him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." And Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." So fasting in humility and dependence upon God is also a way for us to discipline our bodies in such a way that we gain spiritual strength. Spiritual strength to fight even spiritual battles, as is the case here with Christ. Because when we are hungry, we realize how much we depend upon that food. When we are fasting with a spiritual purpose, all of a sudden we begin to understand in humility that we are utterly dependent upon God for the next breath that we take. God has given this as a symbolic illustration. Our dependence upon food needs to be shifted away from that and on to God. And in humility, then we call upon Him. And when we do, we receive the spiritual strength that we need to make it through. One writer said something like this: if we can say no to food for our own sake, we can say no to sin for righteousness' sake. That's the lesson here. When we come in humility and dependence upon God, God will give us a spiritual strength to be able to fight spiritual battles, maybe even battles in our own life that we've never been able to defeat before in our lives. Next, if we want to fast and to pray, when we want to fast and pray to demonstrate repentance from sin. And then also to intercede for others who need to repent. In the book of Jonah, the story is told of that prophet receiving instructions to take God's message to his arch enemies and the arch enemies of God's people, the Ninevites. They were terribly cruel people. Jonah's response is an incredible story. You know, he gets the invitation to go preach to these people that they repent. He goes the other way, which is often what we do. Like, we have a great opportunity to witness to somebody and to share the invitation that we've received from God with somebody else. Hey, why don't you come and see? Come and meet Jesus. We run the other way. That's what Jonah did. But I don't want to focus on that part of the story. I want to focus on what finally happened. When Jonah got to Nineveh and pronounced God's coming judgment upon the people of Nineveh, here's how it goes in Jonah chapter 3. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now, Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Verse 4 of chapter 3 says, Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. They believed Jonah's message, which was from God. And so look what happens. They believed God that they were going to be overthrown. And a fast was proclaimed. And all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth, humility. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he arose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself in sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation he issued in Nineveh. By decree of the king and his nobles, do not let the people or animals or herds or flocks taste anything, a complete fast. Do not let them eat or drink, but let the people and the animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently upon God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. This is a pagan king. And then verse 10 says this. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. It's an incredible story. God had planned to wipe out this people. But when they turned to him in prayer and fasting, he changed his mind and they were saved. It's one thing to pray for yourself and say, oh Lord, I'm sorry that I've done this or I've done that. But it's something else to deprive yourself of food, to plead with God for him to have mercy on you, for your sins that you've committed against him, that they might be forgiven, that you might be spared. And if you're in that situation where there is a certain sin that is constantly besetting you, ensnaring you, like the book of Hebrews talks about, if you are willing to pay the price of fasting and prayer, here's the invitation. Do it. Why? Because that may be the only way that the power of that sin is broken off your life and that you may ever know the deliverance and the joy that follows. It happened with the Ninevites. It can happen with you. We fast and pray so that we can be forgiven and prepared for God's service. A decision to fast in that sort of situation demonstrates to God that we're really serious about our repentance and that we seriously long to make things right with him and then to regain our lives, because that's what sin does. It steals the very life from us. If you think not, what are the wages of sin? Death. And when we sin, we die just a little bit more. But when we repent, God gives us our life back. In the same way, there may be times over the next 10 years, you may be facing something right now with somebody that you know that's very close to you. But over the next 10 years, and as we start this process over the next 40 days, that when we fast and pray, that we would not only do it for ourselves and our own personal cleansing and forgiveness in repentance, there may be some people in your life right now that you will begin to fast and pray for because they need God's help to be delivered from whatever has ensnared them. They won't be able to do it themselves, maybe. You may have to do it for them, to intercede, to fast and pray on behalf of another, on behalf of our nation, our community, our church, your friends, the people in your family, for God's forgiveness and mercy. When it becomes apparent that our regular prayers for these situations are not having an effect, there is something that we can do to turn up our spiritual prayer power. That is to fast for people or for situations that so desperately need God's mercy and God's grace. And the only way the answer is going to come is by prayer and fasting. There's many other categories and many other reasons in Scripture why people would fast and pray. I just want to give you one more. We want to fast and pray to receive God's wisdom and God's direction. And I'm reminded of the incidents that take place in the church at Antioch in Acts chapter 13 and Acts chapter 14. Acts chapter 13, 1 through 3 says this. Now the church at Antioch, in that church there were prophets and teachers. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. Here, the early church was blessed with prophets and teachers, all gifted with the ability to lead a church, but instead of relying on their own gifts, we find the leaders of the church fasting and praying to God for wisdom on how to proceed as a church. And it was only after that they had paid that price of fasting and prayer that God revealed to them what the next steps should be. That they should send Barnabas and Saul off as missionaries. Imagine sending those two guys off. Paul, this incredible rabbi, right, teacher, he has no equal of his day. He's the best. Now that Jesus is not on the earth anymore, Paul is the best. And he's hardcore. And Barnabas is like the soft part. It's like the mom and the dad. I don't know which is which in your family, but hey, there's one soft and there's one hard. These guys together, the church realizes we're going to send our top two guys away from here to go take the message. And they fasted and they prayed. And that was the outcome. Then in the very next chapter of the story, we're told that Saul, who's now going by Paul because he's out in the Gentile world, that's part of the mission, right? And Barnabas went about setting apart leaders in fledgling churches that they had just planted out on this mission trip. Acts 14 says this in verse 21, beginning there. They returned to Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch, strengthening the disciples and encouraging them to remain true to the faith. Verse 23 says, Acts 14, Paul and Barnabas appointed elders for them in each church and, with prayer and fasting, committed them to the Lord in whom they had put their trust. By doing this, the apostles demonstrated to God that they needed the power of the Holy Spirit to guide their decision making. They fasted and they prayed in order to hear more clearly from God and in order to set apart these new leaders with their blessing and with spiritual power to do the work of the ministry. And I can't help but pause just before I go to the final point and wrap this up for today. Oh, how I dream that our church would become like the church that I just read about, the church at Antioch. But I'm not just dreaming, I'm fasting and I'm praying and inviting you to do the same. The church at Antioch was the first beachhead in the invasion of the gospel into the pagan world. May we fast and pray like that church. Barnabas mentored Paul there, and they became a missionary and discipleship hub for the entire Gentile world. May we fast and pray like the early believers in Antioch. They were a well-taught church in the doctrines of God from the pages of Scripture. So many pagans were saved that the city took notice and gave them a name that stuck. Those Christians, those Christ followers. The church at Antioch was almost a blueprint for the type of church that grows when God's word is carefully taught, lived out, and embraced. We're looking at one of the healthiest, most in step with the Spirit churches in the New Testament. We're looking at the place where evangelism and discipleship flourished, teaching, missions, and church planting became the norm, a place where ministry was surrounded by what? Prayer and fasting. May we fast and may we pray like the church at Antioch. When we need wisdom, we should use the gift of prayer and fasting, which will focus our minds on whatever situation that we're praying about. Every time we desire food, we're reminded to pray for God to speak. Instead of sitting down to a meal with others, we get up and we go away to be alone with the Lord and we ask Him to reveal His will to us. And then we sit back and we wait for God to answer. That's what prayer and fasting does in the church, in the life of the believers that would believe, dare, humble themselves enough to be obedient to Jesus' instruction for us to fast and to pray. So, again, why are we talking about all of this? Well, it's to prepare us for what we're asking God to do in our own church over the next 10 years. We've been in this series, The Invitation, because our governing body here in Ohio of the Assemblies of God, the Ohio Ministry Network, has invited us to dream with them on this initiative, Ohio for Jesus. And for our part, that means we prayerfully intend to reach and disciple, I hope this number is too small, and this is over the next 10 years, 750 people for Jesus. And by the way, planting two churches in the process. This is big. This is bigger than what I can dream in actuality. But with God, it's possible. And I'm inviting every one of you, because I can't do it alone. God is inviting all of you as well, for all of us to partner together and to partner with Him, inviting every one of us to be involved beginning this fall with 40 days of prayer and fasting. Jesus is building His church, and He'll do it with or without us. And He's invited us, though, to work with Him. And by inviting others, we can do the same. We extend that same invitation. We invite people to come and see, because we know that if we can get people in the presence of Jesus, He can change anything in anybody. We're invited to go and be His witnesses, His church in the world, inviting others into what we've been invited to be a part of, His church, with that same invitation that we ourselves have received. We should never then underestimate the power of an invitation. I talked last week about an invitation to go on a blind date. That's my wife for 36 years. I never knew. Invitations are powerful. You never know what an invitation can do in a person's life. God could use a preacher. God could use a TV program or written material. God could use all types of things to draw people to Jesus. But I believe that the gospel would reach the world if every believer would invite their circle of influence. I believe the gospel would reach the world and change individuals, change families, change entire towns and cities beyond our wildest dreams. People would be saved and healed. Joy would be restored. Eternal life would spread. When you and I just invite our circle of influence. So as we begin to embark on this dream, I'm going to ask you to accept the invitation. Let's do it, though, with the spiritual wherewithal that comes from prayer and fasting. That's where we want to begin. And then we just want to step back and we want to watch God work. We want to watch the Holy Spirit begin to draw people. We want to watch Jesus build His church, even at this location. We know those things are God's will. So prayer and fasting is part of our strategy as we prepare then for our upcoming outreach, Beggar's Night Pit Stop. So beginning this coming Friday on September 20th and then going through Wednesday, October 30th, we want to take 40 days to pray and to fast. And with that said, so this is an all-church invitation for everyone to be involved. With that said, let me give you a little practical direction here to clarify just a few things, okay? Now, in just a moment, I want to get started with the sign-up, and we have cards to help us to be able to do that. I don't want you to be intimidated by this, okay? We are not asking anyone to fast for 40 days. That wouldn't even be wise. It takes too much of a toll on your body. That's something that you have to work up to. You can't just do that. So we're not asking anybody to fast for 40 days, but we would at least ask you to pray for those 40 days. But our goal still, at the same time, is to have at least one person fasting each day of the 40 days. So if everyone would sign up for just one day, if you would sign up for just one day, we would have it all covered. And then some. Some will do several days in a row. And that's cool too. Some may spread it out. You may do some in the beginning, middle, and end. Maybe one in the beginning, one in the middle, one at the end. It doesn't matter how you decide to do it. I'm only inviting you to do it. And it's only one day. One day of fasting out of 40 and praying. What exactly do you mean by fasting? We're talking about going without solid food, without your normal three meals or however it is that you eat. That's a starting point. If you'd like to fast, abstain from something else, television, the internet, to give that time to God and to pray, that's wonderful. But in the Bible, fasting has to do with food, and that's the pattern that we're going with here. If some of you have dietary or medical issues, like we talked about last week, you can still participate to the extent that it's wise for you and according to your doctor's orders. Kids, they can do it too. They should just talk to their parents about it first. In the Bible, there are at least three different kinds of fasting. There's a full fast. Like in Nineveh, no food, no drink. We're not asking anybody to do that. No food whatsoever, no drink whatsoever. We're talking about another kind of fast. That's a regular fast. That is refraining from eating all food. Most people still drink water or juice during a regular fast, and this is what we're asking. You can drink till the cows come home. Just don't eat food. There's also a partial fast. This type of fast generally refers to omitting a specific meal from your diet or refraining from certain types of foods. This may work if you have a dietary restriction. Go a day fasting what you know is healthy for you to be able to fast. It's still considered a fast. And it would still be acceptable for what I'm inviting you into. So, generally, I'm inviting you into a fast to abstain from food, not from what you might drink during that day, but rather just from food. There are private and corporate fasts, as I said. This is a corporate fast. So we're doing this all together. Everybody might know that you're fasting, but they don't necessarily need to know when you're fasting. Remember, Jesus said, when you fast, don't do it like the hypocrites and let everybody know that you're doing it. Do it in secret so that your God, so that our God can reward us in private. So let me give you some directions further and help you with praying during this time. Now we have cards and we're going to pass them out in just a second. Take the time that you would spend eating to pray. Concerning how you pray, check your motives. We've talked about that today. Pray from a heart of obedience to God. Pray from a place of humility and dependence. Personally repent if necessary. Concerning what to pray, generally pray for personal wisdom and guidance. And the same for our church leadership, members, and attenders. Pray for His will for our church to go forward over these next 10 years. Specifically, pray for family members, friends, your neighbors, this community, that they might accept an invitation that we would extend to meet Jesus. That the Holy Spirit would prepare us for the beggar's night pit stop. That He would draw people onto our property ready to meet Jesus. Even if it means coming to church to do it. That they would be freed from any hindrance, spiritual or otherwise, that would keep them from coming to meet Jesus. That everyone would be safe that evening. That God would use you personally to extend an invitation to a person to come and see. You could pray for yourself at breakfast time, for your circle of influence, that would be your friends, family, neighbors, the people that you bump into every day, the people that you really carry a burden for the most. Pray for them at lunchtime and for the community in the pit stop during your evening mealtime. You could mix it up. Doesn't matter. No matter how you do it, we just ask that you would do it. Focus on fasting and praying that people would get saved, that they would come to church, that they would be discipled, and then they then would go out and invite their circle of influence to do the same thing, to accept the same invitation that has been accepted to them, extended to them, and that they have accepted. Pray for people that you haven't seen in church for a while, that they would come back, and then text them. Say, hey, I missed you at church. So I'm going to ask the ushers to come right now. We have these cards, and they're two-sided. And I just want everybody to take one. They're two-sided, a place for you to fill out the same information on both sides. And we didn't quite get them perforated. And they're going to pass them out, and I'm just asking you to put your name on it and the dates that you'll fast. Fill out the information there on both sides. I'm going to tell a story here in just a minute to close, and I'll reiterate this again at the end, I think. And we're going to collect these in a minute. And then you can bring them back next week if you want to pray about it this week or whatever. And we're going to drop them in the offering basket. And what we've done is we've already made a sheet of all the dates. And we're going to take your name, and we're just going to mark off that date that somebody is fasting on that day and somebody is praying on that day. Nobody has to know what it is that you're doing. It's a corporate prayer. We all, in fast time, we all know that we're doing it, but nobody has to know when we're doing it. We want to hold to that standard. And so we will just mark off that date, and we're going to try to get coverage for 40 days. Now, don't make me have to fast too much. What, everybody chooses one day and I get 39, right? I'm going to ask if you're prepared to just choose that date, write it on the card and drop it in the basket in a minute when it comes by, and we'll begin to mark those days off, and we'll do it again next week. Just because we're doing it next week doesn't mean that you have to wait. Pick a date. Keep the copy. Drop it in the basket. Now, before we go any further and finish up with this exercise, I want to tell you this story. It's a true story. It's been reported in numerous newspapers. In Mount Vernon, Texas, Drummond's Bar began construction on the expansion of their bar to increase business. The local Baptist church started a campaign to block the bar from expanding with petitions, fasting, and prayer. Work progressed on the bar right up until the week of the reopening, when suddenly lightning struck the bar and burned it to the ground. That's not the funny part. After the bar burned to the ground due to the lightning strike, the church folks were rather smug and started bragging about the power of their prayers. That is, until the bar owner sued the church on the grounds that the church was ultimately responsible for the demise of his building, either through direct or indirect means. In its reply to the court, the church vehemently denied all responsibility in any connection to the church to the bar's demise. So the judge read the bartender's complaint and the church's reply, and then he said, and I quote, "I don't know how I'm going to decide on this case. It appears by the paperwork that we have a bar owner who believes in the power of fasting and prayer, an entire congregation of a church who does not believe in the power of fasting and prayer. I have a dilemma. The bar believes. The church doesn't. How am I going to rule on this?" And that is a dilemma. Well, I've come to announce today that according to this invitation that I'm extending today, that there is still a church in the earth that believes in the power of fasting and prayer. It may be new to some of you, but it's in the Bible. It's a Bible thing. It's a thing that moves God's hand, that accomplishes God's will. May that church be Centerbrook Church, and may it start now. So I want to just give you 30 seconds to pray. If you haven't already filled in a date, that's fine. And I want you then to commit to that date and drop it in the bag. I'll ask the guys to come forward again in 30 seconds. When you guys come forward, we'll start working our way back and we'll collect any of them, any of these little slips that we have. Again, if you want to pray and consider and bring it back next week, that's fine. If you want to add days next week, by the way, that's fine too. We'll block them off the calendar and we'll let you know next week what is still available. So take a couple of seconds. Let's pray, and then we'll collect and begin to mark off the dates until we fill up that 40 days. Just personally pray and ask God what He wants you to do. Lord, now be with your people as they accept the invitation to be a part of what you're doing here at Centerbrook Church. By our commitment to fasting and praying, we're asking your will to be done over the next 10 years and even longer, really, in the life of our church. We're asking, God, that people in our family, that this community would be revolutionized by the power of your Spirit, by the saving knowledge of your Son Jesus Christ coming into their lives simply because we have petitioned to the throne of God with fasting and prayer. Give us wisdom as a church on how to proceed in this time. Thank you, Lord, that people will be fasting and praying for that. Lord, I pray, God, that we would experience in these 40 days a sense of personal cleansing through repentance and fasting and prayer, a new awareness of humility before God, a new sense of obedience to the expectations that Christ has for us as His followers. God, may this not be a futile exercise, but rather may we do it with the right heart, imploring You to lead and guide our church and to save people in our families and in our community, bringing them into the church, entrusting them to us. Lord, I pray that we would all be on board. We would all accept the invitation now. In Jesus' name, amen. Gentlemen. Stand with me if you would, and let's dismiss. I want to thank you for already accepting the invitation. And if you weren't able to do it today, pray about it this week and come back next week ready to do that. Just to fast and pray along with everyone else. I know it can be terrifying. Get over your phobia of fasting. You can do it. You can do it. Next week, we have a special treat. Rob Worley, the missionary, kids guy, he'll be preaching. Everyone else who is running in the Air Force 10K, hopefully will be here, but we'll be recovering and very tired. And we want to see you here, and we're going to follow up on all of this, and we're going to just expect God to do incredible things this fall in our church, with our kids, and in our lives, because we've endeavored to petition God's throne with prayer and fasting just to see what He'll do in our church and in the ministry that He's given each one of us. Lord, bless Your people. Bring them back tonight for a wonderful movie. May our hearts be stirred to action and to obedience and to humility and dependence upon You in this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you guys. I can only imagine that you'll all be back tonight. Come on back. It's a great movie.